Okay, I would like to thank Aubrey for the invitation to this excellent meeting. So I will today I'm going to tell you two stories that have to do with our efforts to undo certain processes that occur with age and with this increased entropy that we observe. So the first one will have to do with comparative biology approach to aging that we use. So as you can see, in nature we can find animals with wide range of lifespans, from very short-lived, which are, for better or worse, are the most commonly used laboratory models, like mice and other model organisms, all the way to a very long-lived species like bowhead whale that lives 200 years, which makes it 100-fold difference between different mammals in their longevity. So if we could find what makes animals on this end of the spectrum different from these ones and then apply it to people, so that may result in a very significant improvement. So I will focus on this rodent for now. Well, it lives 32 years. It may not be as impressive as bowhead whale, but if you just look at rodents, it is the longest lived rodent. And in addition to being so long lived for such a small creature, it's the same size as a mouse. Naked mole rats are also resistant to pretty much all age-related diseases. So they have very low frequency of cancer. In fact, there are only 4 cases reported. They are resistant to osteoarthritis. I'm not going to talk much about it, but we experimentally tried to induce arthritis, and when mice develop arthritis in a few weeks, naked mole rats just don't, even on the injured, in the injured knees. They are very resistant to ischemia reperfusion, and people don't find any evidence of neurodegenerative processes in their brain. So all this makes them a really exciting model. They were named Vertebrate of the Year in 2013. Thanks to this discovery that came from our group, where we first focused on their resistance to cancer, so I will briefly review that, and then I will tell you, for the where are we going with that now? Yeah, so they like to be on the covers of very good journals because they can turn the clock backwards. But let's come back to cancer. So when we first started working on naked mole rat, all we knew, okay, this animal lives 10 times longer than a standard laboratory rodent, and they don't get cancer. But like, where do we start? So we started by culturing cells and just looking for clues. And we noticed something very peculiar, that cells of naked mole rats, when they're cultured in the media, they make media viscous. So there is some kind of goo secreted by the cells. We didn't know what it was. And after a lot of searching, we found that this goo was hyaluronic acid, or hyaluronan, which is a very important component of extracellular matrix that is found in multiple tissues, in humans as well. And it's not only it absorbs water, it's a lubricant, and it also participates in signaling. So it's a signaling molecule. It binds to receptors on cell surface. And it's already been used in the clinic for various local applications, arthritis treatment, in eye surgery, and so on. But hasn't been used really in any kind of systemic approach. So when we looked at hyaluronan in the naked mole rat, we were astonished to find that in the naked mole rat, so here it's a gel separating hyaluronan, and we are comparing naked mole rat to several other species. And you can see they have so much more of it, and also the size is much greater. So hyaluronan is a polysaccharide, linear polysaccharide. So these chains are 10 times longer in naked mole rat than in human, and there is probably more than 10 times more abundant. So what does it mean in terms of cancer? So what we demonstrated just in one slide here, that if we try to take normal mouse cells and make a tumor out of it, so we can introduce two hits, two mutational hits, and make a tumor. The same hits don't work in naked mole rat cells. The cells don't form a tumor unless we also prevent these cells from making hyaluronan. So if we prevent them from making hyaluronan, voila, we get tumors. So basically what it means, we prevent naked mole rat cells from making hyaluronan and they become as susceptible to cancer as mice. So of course the next question we asked was, okay, hyaluronan protects naked mole rat from cancer, but will it protect other species? Can we take it to the mouse? Will it do any better? Like, can we do this? So to test that as a proof of principle, we now took it to the mouse model, because naked mole rat is great for discovery phase, but then for really testing interventions, we need to go to a short-lived organism where we have all the molecular tools to manipulate them. So we made transgenic mice. So these mice carry the gene for hyaluronan synthase. And we started breeding these mice. Oh, and one thing I forgot to mention. So there are two reasons naked mole rats produce so much hyaluronan. First, their synthase is a little bit special. I will not go into detail for the interest of time. And second, the degradation phase is very slow. So they're just very slow at degrading hyaluronan. So in this mouse, we address the synthesis part. So one very exciting finding that we are, you know, now wrapping up for publication. Oh, and by the way, so I would like to ask you not to take pictures starting from this slide. Let's keep it confidential. So what we found that naked mole, these mice, transgenic mice with naked mole rat gene, they have improved hematopoietic stem cell maintenance. So here we are looking at the number of hematopoietic stem cells. It's increased about threefold in these mice. And these cells, they don't just increase, they're actually functional. So if we transplant them to a wild-type mouse competitively, so those from transgenic mice outcompete the wild-type. So these are good stem cells and they're better at engrafting. And if you think about it, you know, keeping your stem cells intact is a very good strategy for long life. So by overproducing hyaluronan in the bone marrow of these mice, we can improve their stem cell maintenance. But now, of course, you must be thinking, what about longevity, right? So these results are very, very new, because as you can imagine, longevity experiment in the mouse, well, it doesn't take 30 years as in a naked mole rat, but it takes 3 years. So here are some pictures, so you can just look. So these mice are 2 years old. So this is the wild type, and this is the transgenic. So you can see, well, these look a little bit more scruffy. Do they feel scruffy? So that's, here is, we decided to stress these mice a little bit. So these are also aged mice. This, and on the treadmill test. So if we do it on young control versus transgenic, they're pretty much the same. But if we take 2-year-old mice, you can see what happens. So you see, this is the wild type. It's exhausted, it needs rest. And the transgenic just goes, they don't care, you know, they're like almost like young wild type. So that was very, very exciting to see, because, you know, we really care about health span, right, besides the lifespan. So not only live longer, but, you know, to stay like that, you know, keep running. So this is quantification of the experiment. So you can see distance to exhaustion. Almost in the aged mice, almost twofold difference in the transgenic. Grip strength, so that's a test that's often used in human patients. Again, transgenics are outcompete, and inverted screen, another physical exercise test for mice. Again, transgenics perform so much better. And the lifespan data is not final because these cohorts are still, you know, mice are 2 years old, so they started dying, but we still have some survivors. But preliminary data looks like that. So there is significant lifespan extension. It's not as dramatic as what we see with their health span. But I think this is fine, because, you know, being healthy till the very end is, you know, maybe even more important. And one thing as you know, you might have thought about it. So we only address the synthesis in these mice. So degradation is still raging on. So the level of increase in hyaluronan was actually quite modest compared to naked mole rat. And we already have almost twofold improvement in health span. So I think the potential is great there. So here is, again, I don't have time to go into, you know, these are all other projects in the lab where You know, we are finding other exciting adaptations in naked MORAD, from stable epigenome to mTOR inhibition. And many of these adaptations are actually mediated by this unique property of hyaluronan in these animals. So, of course, the next question is, how do we take it from naked MORAD and bring it to human? And, of course, making transgenic humans may not be very practical. So here we are taking a different approach. So instead of playing with the synthesis, we want to inhibit degradation. And we design a screen for inhibitors of the enzyme that degrade hyaluronan. We have some very promising hits right now. And this way, we can actually systemically manipulate hyaluronan, hopefully in human patients. And some of the molecules that we find, they are plant-derived. They have really very good toxicity profile, so maybe, you know, good for healthy people. So to summarize this part of the talk, so this is the strategy we took with comparative biology approach. We picked different species that are exceptional in their longevity. So, and this is natural longevity. They evolved it over millions of years. I didn't have time to talk about very large animals, blind mole rats, squirrels, and bats. We're actually working on all of them. And in each case, we find a unique adaptation. They don't all evolve the same thing, and that's the beauty of it, because then we can take all these adaptations, and then if we can somehow adapt them for human use, then we can actually improve it human biology in multiple ways. So once we identify molecular mechanism here, so we talked about hyaluronan, we didn't talk about other things, we make this proof of principle mouse model, and from there we can think about how to adapt it for human intervention. Okay, so in the remaining few minutes, let me switch gears and talk about another area of concern in the cell with age, because here we talked about extracellular matrix. Now we are moving into the nucleus, our genome. So there is a lot of entropy in our genome. So the coding genes only constitute a very small portion of our genome, and there is a lot of these repetitive sequences called transposable elements or retrotransposons that just accumulated there, and if they sit quietly, they don't make a problem. But what we've shown previously that during aging, they may get activated. And you can imagine if 30%, over 30% of our genome is made up of those sequences, when they all start to be expressed, and some of them have also propensity to move around, so that may be a problem. We also found, quickly reviewing it, that in the cell, so there are multiple mechanisms to suppress these transposable elements. One of them that we identified is this gene called SIRT2N6 that is actually very famous for many other reasons. But one of its very important functions is to silence transposable elements. And during aging, SIRT2N6, it's also involved in DNA repair, other important processes, so somehow it gets titrated out, so there is less SIRT2N6 on transposons, they start to be activated. And then that's when bad things can happen. But of course, big question here was activation of transposon, does it cause some of aging-related pathology, or is it just something that happens and it's insignificant? So to address that, we had to actually try to prevent it from happening and see if we can slow down aging. And we have a mouse model that is mutated in this gene SIRT2N6. These mice are very short-lived, 30 days, and they display properties of premature aging. So we thought, okay, so what if we take these mice and then treat them with drugs that will prevent transposon activation? Would they live longer? And very conveniently, such drugs are already available. So they were developed for completely different reasons. So transposons, they move because they express enzyme called reverse transcriptase that's also present in viruses. And we have HIV drugs that were developed to inhibit HIV reverse transcriptase, and some of them can also cross-react with L1 or this retrotransposon reverse transcriptase. So we gave these drugs, so these are the two drugs that we use, we gave these drugs to the mice, to the mutant mice, and we observed what happened. So one very unexpected finding there was that in these mice, there was very high expression of interferons, interferon alpha, interferon beta. So these are inflammatory molecules, they signal inflammation. And if we give the drugs, they completely suppress this inflammation. So that was quite important finding in and of itself, because aging is associated in increased of sterile inflammation. And the causes of that are not, you know, very well understood. And here we can see that perhaps transposable elements that start to be activated, they transcribe, they form DNA fragments that then can happen in the cytoplasm, and they are recognized as if we are infected with the virus. So the innate immune system sees those pieces of DNA in the cytoplasm, they're not supposed to be there, so it activates immune response against invading viruses, even though there are really no viruses, they've been sitting there all along. And this increase in inflammation can be very deleterious. So the drugs completely suppress it. They also suppress DNA damage induced by transposons. And if we look at pathology in these mice, they have very severe colitis. So this is what intestinal tissue should look like in a normal mouse. In the knockouts, it's a total mess. So the epithelium is really falling apart. But with the treatments, we see quite a significant improvement. And overall, you can see, so these are the mice in the open field test. So basically, if you put a mouse in the middle of this circle, it tries to escape. So we measure how long it takes to walk away. So this is the knockout. See, it's just not going anywhere. The wild type, so this is what normal mice do. And these are mice treated with antiretroviral drugs. So you see they're a little bit unsteady on their feet, but they're so much better than this. Okay. And most important, aging. So this is the lifespan. We could get twofold improvement in lifespan. Okay, these are very short-lived mice, but you know, 60 days over 30 days is highly significant. So the treatment improve the lifespan. So what we can conclude here is that L1 activation, L1 is the name of the most abundant retrotransposon, contributes to age-related pathologies, first by producing these DNA fragments in the cytoplasm that then trigger interferon response. And another way, L1 expresses a nuclease that can go and cleave DNA in random places and produce DNA damage. So these pathologies can be suppressed by the drugs. The drugs that we used may not be ideal. I mean, they have their side effects, but they were selected to work against HIV. So maybe if we were to look something specific against line 1 reverse transcriptase or other aspects of line 1 biology, we could come up with better solutions. And this is really what happens. These transposable elements, they're like sleeping dogs in our genome, but as we get older, they wake up and they start to generate damage, induce inflammation, and contribute to aging as a causal effect. So I would like to thank members of my group. You know, there are very talented people here whose work I mentioned. Xiao Tian, Zhong Hiki worked on stem cells, and Matt Simon, who developed the project on transposable elements. We have excellent collaborators, Andrei Siluanov, Jan Vig, Vadim Gladyshev, and we collaborate also with John Sedivy on Line 1 project. Our funding is mostly comes from the National Institutes of Health. We've also been funded by AFAR, Glenn Foundation, and Life Extension Foundation. We are very grateful to this foundation for their support. We have not been funded by SENS, so maybe it's time. And of course, I would like to acknowledge Naked Mole Rats for their contribution. And thank you very much for your attention.